Fighting Through World War II, Episode 77. The Able Queen. Tales of an Indiana Hump Pilot Lost in the Himalayas by Rainy Hovarth. More great unpublished history.
Hiya, fellas. This is Woody Herman speaking. We're making V-discs today, and now we'd like to do a tune for you called Apple Honey. It's a jumper. We hope you get a kick out of it.
We were given missions to deliver bombs and gasoline to one of two airfields that were surrounded by the Japanese, and we could only get in there with a fighter escort. We realised that we'd have to abandon ship and started making preparations before our fuel ran out. Secret codes were destroyed. All charts with radio frequencies were destroyed. The Chinese family was plastered against the far wall, eyes wide open, and with the most frightful look frozen on their faces that I had ever seen. Now I was the only one left to jump. I jumped clear and was falling, tumbling through the pitch-black night. I realised that I must now pull the ripcord and get on with this business of surviving. And as I bailed out of the Able Queen that cold night in February and watched her disappear behind the clouds, I looked up at the stars and wondered how I got there. Hello again, and a happy new year welcome to the Fighting Through Second World War podcast. I'm Paul Cheel, son of Bill Cheel, whose World War II memoirs have been published by Pen and Sword in Fighting Through from Dunkirk to Hamburg. The aim of this podcast is to give you the stories behind the story. You'll hear memoirs and interviews with veterans in all the countries and all the forces. In the show preview, you heard a few sound bites from the story we're about to hear from American Rainy Hovarth about her father's war in China, my goodness. And you also heard a fleeting intro to the first topic, which is vintage music. So in this episode, we've got the air war in China, old records, a Victoria Cross story, plus several family stories. Ooh, and I'll also be interviewing Rainy about her dad's war in this episode's featured memoir. Before we get too deep, just a bit of a follow-up on the last episode, the Christmas at War one. Janice Blake from the USA bought me some Calvados. Thank you, Janice. And she went on to say, "From Jingle Bells to Silent Night, this episode embodied the true spirit of Christmas as it was lived by the men who couldn't come home for the holidays during those grim years of warfare. Yet this podcast proves to us that somehow the spirit of Christmas lived in their hearts. Thank you, Paul, for putting us all in touch with that spirit. Janice." Oh, thank you, Janice. And also to several other people who left word that they enjoyed that Christmas episode. And apparently that truce in the forest story at the end was actually made into a movie, would you believe? And it was called Silent Night, what else? By the Hallmark Channel at a Google search engine near you. So that was episode 76, Christmas at War, if you missed it. But save it till next year this time, eh? I've got a bit of magnificent music history now from listener Giancarlo Cervone from Rochester in New York. Giancarlo wrote in saying, "I'm an avid collector of 78 RPM records, which of course cover the time from the teens through around 1956. I specialise in blues and jazz recordings. There's a lot of recordings that reference World War II either what's going on in the various theatres of operations or related to things on the home front like rationing, shortages, missed loved ones, hope for the end of the war, etc. I also have a number of V-discs, which were special recordings pressed by the US War Department to be sent overseas for the exclusive enjoyment of service people. There are hundreds of releases covering all aspects of American music, and sometimes you'll hear someone like Duke Ellington or Woody Herman giving a message to the troops at the beginning of the record before the music. They were supposed to be destroyed after the war, but many have survived and are prized by collectors. Giancarlo, thank you so much for that. So this music on these old records is what would have helped to motivate the troops fighting out in the Far East in Europe. I don't think my dad ever played much more than a game of cards, but I'm going to share with you this short passage from his memoirs because it does mention music. Dad was wounded fighting in Normandy in June 44, and he was taken to Scotland to recuperate. And he was just coming out of Dundee Hospital in Scotland, and here's what he said in his memoirs. I was now taken by ambulance to a convalescent home. It seemed a long time since I was sitting in the back of that three-tonner on the morning of D-Day, although it was only 2 months ago. Until I went to Dundee, I'd only ever been to Scotland for training, but of course I'd heard all about it from the various Scots lads I'd met in the army, who are always canny lads. My dealings with the Scots I'd met in Dundee confirmed my opinion that they were a generous race of people. It was a glorious morning travelling through the hills and countryside of Scotland, and I was in a very reflective mood. In fact, all 10 of us in the truck seem engrossed with our own thoughts, going over and over the past weeks, totally absorbed about where we'd been and where we were going. My immediate future was very certain. I was going somewhere in a three-tonner, my life in the hands of the army. For the past 5 years, I'd been number 439-0717. How much longer would it last? It just seemed to go on and on. I was taken to the village of Killin, and how I'd remember that name in years to come. I was situated on the southern end of Loch Tay in Perthshire, and our new home, Orkmore House, was about 1.5 miles from Killin. Orkmore House was a large old residence, and in its heyday must have been magnificent, and in a way still was, situated in its own extensive grounds. Like the hospital, it was staffed by excellent, caring nurses, and we were there to convalesce. It was a rest home for about 50 soldiers, and it proved to be a good move being sent there. We were all accommodated in small rooms, and as we were here to recuperate, a great deal of leisure time was available, during which we'd just read, write or play cards. But we were free to do almost as we wished, though we had a set routine of light exercises and massaging every day according to our wounds. But there was a good deal of free time to do as we pleased. There was a well-stocked library, a wireless, and a gramophone with a with a good selection of records. These leisure activities may not seem very exciting, but to us who'd been used to a strict army routine, they were ideal under the circumstances, and they were conducive to recuperation. When I wasn't reading the books in the library, most of my time was passed making notes and writing of my kaleidoscope of experiences over the past weeks while they were fresh in my mind. We'd walk in the grounds, which were extensive, and I found a huge pine tree which had been planted by Queen Victoria. I thought, to think that I'm standing where that great queen herself has stood. The ink spots were all the rage then, better songs than the tuneless stuff they churn out today. Oh dear, how about that then? I wonder if my dad managed to get his hands on any V-discs. Needless to say, I recently got my hands on Spotify, and for a brief journey back in time to 1944, I immersed myself in all that the Ink Spots had to offer my dad. Brilliant. I'm going to make a confession now. You know when you were younger and you wanted to make some extra cash and you'd raid your parents' house for anything that wasn't nailed down and sell it in a car boot sale or a yard sale? Well, I remember once selling some old 78s of the Ink Spots of my dad's that way, and I feel really guilty about it, mad even, that I could let some of my heritage slip through my hands so easily. But I do remember asking my dad about them at the time, and he didn't seem bothered about them, so off they went for sale in a farmer's muddy field. I can only think someone must have bought them who had a genuine interest in them, so I'm pleased about that, but I do now so wish I'd kept them. Giancarlo has sent me some short audio samples of V-discs, and I'm going to play them now for you. He says this first one is the opening to St. Louis Blues March by Captain Glenn Miller and the 418th Army Air Force Band, recorded in October 1943. Gian said, as you probably know, Miller had one of the most popular bands in the States and joined the Army Air Force, bringing in the sounds of the popular swing style to the military band arena. I guess he was popular in other countries too. I actually have an English pressing of one of his records. Sadly, the plane he was in was lost over the Atlantic during the war. I've seen some memorabilia of him in the US Air Force Museum in Dayton, Ohio. Next is Apple Honey by Woody Herman and his orchestra, recorded in September 44. This was actually before they made the commercial studio recording of the number for Columbia, which was a hit. Herman played clarinet, alto sax and sang, and was a very popular band leader at this time too. And listener, of course, that's the one you'll have heard in the intro to the show, but here it is again.
Hiya fellas, this is Woody Herman speaking. We're making V-discs today, and now we'd like to do a tune for you called Apple Honey. It's a jumper. We hope you get a kick out of it.
And this last one is the beginning of the great jazz pianist Art Tatum's classic Body and Soul, recorded in October 45 with his introduction. And Gian adds that I love it. And I can see why, because when I first listened to it myself, I thought it went on a bit. But when you've heard it two or three times, you begin to get into it. And it's good. I love it too. Back in November, Giancarlo did a special World War II Veterans Day presentation on Zoom, playing some of the music from the war years from the original 78 RPM recordings. So if that's your sort of thing that might interest you, check out his website at Lakeview Hot Record Club, and there's a link in the show notes. The group's about listening to jazz and blues music of the 20s through to the 1950s, and they meet on Zoom and also in person in New York. Giancarlo, thank you so much for all of that. I'm just loving that music, and you've inspired me to create and share a Spotify playlist of music, war music, that I've been compiling for a couple of years now, and I've added these tunes to the others which are connected to Dad's book or the Fighting Through podcast. And there's Lily Marlene by Marlene Dietrich, dripping in poignancy if you've never heard it, and you must. And one of Dad's pals once typed out the words to that song for him. And there's that great thumping, booming German marching song with the catchy title of Auf der Heideblucht ein kleines Blümlein. I thought it meant let's go and give those Tommies a right kick up the bottom, but apparently it reads on the heath a little flower blooms. I bet you've heard it before, though, and if the Germans had fought the war based on their marching songs rather than their Messerschmitts, they'd have probably slaughtered us. But much as Churchill once predicted that if we were beaten, then our Commonwealth allies from far across the seas would come and rescue us. And so the glorious Green Howard's Bonnie English Rose would have come belting over the hill to sort us out. On a quieter note, there's everyone's very own Michael Bublé crooning out You'll Never Know, which Dad recalled from his time stationed in Germany at the end of the war. So who'd have thunk Michael Bublé would be singing that today? You'll never know just how much I miss you. Get me off quick. There's a Spotify link to all these records in the show notes, and it's free to listen to. You may have to download a Spotify player, but that will be free as well. And if you look on the Fighting Through podcast music page, there's a new music tab on the menu, and it's everything's in there. Keep it handy for when you read the book. How good would that be? Feedback appreciated on that page. Thank you. And there's more. Giancarlo has created another playlist of his favourite war tracks in celebration of the US's musical morale booster to the war effort. And Hitler might have had V2s, but we had V-discs and 78s. And bombers, bullets and Benito Mussolini all feature in this great set of tracks from Giancarlo of the Lakeview Hot Record Club in New York, in association with the Fighting Through podcast. And you might also find this music's good to listen to as background atmosphere for your next journey down to some of the old war zones. Thanks again, Giancarlo. Moving on now to a new segment on the Victoria Cross. I'm turning to a new occasional segment where we look at someone who's done the VC, the Victoria Cross, and that's the highest award Britain can make for gallantry. Tim Rainville from Canada has been in touch with a background to someone who's won said medal. And Tim says, I just wanted to drop you a quick anecdote recently related to me by a good friend, Terry. As a child, Terry lived in London, Ontario, and had the good fortune to be the neighbour of a certain Major John Mahony, who was a kind, friendly man, very popular with the kids in the neighbourhood. On two occasions, Terry recalled being part of a group who were allowed the rare privilege of viewing John's Victoria Cross from World War II. Being immensely humble, and obviously not wanting to discuss the war with children, Mahony related that the award of the VC was due to his baking. Yes, that's baking as in oven. He said that the Queen of England was especially fond of his muffin recipe, and thus he was honoured with the medal. Like many of us, Terry regretted not having more conversations with Mr. Mahony, who passed away in 1990, before he was sufficiently mature to appreciate the treasure who'd lived next door. And here's Major Mahoney's VC story. John Kiefer Mahoney was born in New Westminster, British Columbia, on 30th of June 1911. Before the Second World War, he was a militia officer in the Westminster Regiment and would remain with the regiment as it was mobilised overseas. On 24th of May 44, Major Mahoney led his company across the Melfa River in Italy under heavy artillery fire. His task was to secure a firm bridgehead on the western side of the river and was part of the operations by 1st Canadian Corps to break through the Adolf Hitler line. Although threatened by vastly superior forces, Mahoney's company managed to hold the bridgehead for 5 hours under continuous fire until reinforcements arrived. In two German counterattacks, his men destroyed 3 enemy self-propelled guns and 1 tank, a significant feat considering they had no anti-tank guns. Though he suffered 3 wounds, Mahoney was a constant source of inspiration and determination throughout as he tirelessly organised the defence, visited his men in their positions, and personally directed the fire of the light anti-tank weapons on hand. For his exemplary leadership and courage in his action, Major Mahoney was awarded the Victoria Cross. He died in London, Ontario, on 15th of December 1990, at the age of 79. A few random shout-outs now. Loving your podcast. My dad served with the Australian Imperial Force in New Guinea, so I was hooked with Leslie Cook, and that's from Tim Duncan in Melbourne. Daniel Canales from California sent greetings. Tom V from Illinois. Callum Walker from Ellesmere Port in the UK, listening daily with goosebumps, eh, Callum? And Nick Denno. Nick, you're from Illinois, age 15. Of course you know that. Nick is a scout working on his Eagle. I used to be in the Scouts, and I still use a round turn and 2 half hitches even today. What a brilliant knot. I use it for all sorts. And Nick says the show keeps him on the edge of his seat on the drive to school. Well, that's okay, Nick, but make sure you keep your seatbelt on, chum. Feedback now from Nancy Spencer. Paul, I wanted to tell you about my visit to the American Cemetery at Omaha Beach in 2018 with my daughter. It's a remarkable place with crosses and stars of David in perfect alignment in all directions. None of the trees are allowed to put on new growth to honour all the young men who died in the flower of their youth. It's very touching. I remember thinking, what would my late husband think about me spending the money to take this trip? The very first grave I walked up to was a soldier named Kansas, the state my husband was from. And he was from New Jersey, the state I'm from. I had my answer. I recommend you visit. It was a great experience. Thanks for the great work. Regards, Nancy Sarah Spencer, Bellens Horney. Nancy, many thanks for that, and we can clearly take that as a thumbs up for visiting the Omaha Cemetery. I've got a bit of a promo for you now. Here's the next interest level for any keen warists and film buffs out there. It's about the Danger Close podcast. Choose your favourite war movie and hear the Danger Close team delve deeper into the ins and outs of it. And it's a smashing history lesson to boot. Here goes.
War is hell. People make films about it. And we love to talk about them. Join a Marine veteran, a film critic, and a theater director as we laugh, argue, and explore the history of humanity's triumphs and tragedies through war films old and new. With new episodes every other Friday, we are Dan, Katie, and Liam, and this is Danger Close.
Thank you, Dan. That's Danger Close on a podcast player near you. And you know, that's really got me in the mood now for telling a story. And here we go with the main event now. Before I get into the nitty-gritty of this episode, I'd like to share a little history with you about China's role in the war. If you're thinking, China? Then listen carefully. Cue Wikipedia. The Japan-China War was fought 1937 to 45. It started with a so-called Marco Polo Bridge incident in July 37, when a dispute between Japanese and Chinese troops in Peking escalated into a full-scale invasion. China was supported by the Soviet Union and the United States. After the Japanese attacks on Malaya and Pearl Harbor in 1941, the war merged with other conflicts. And just in case anyone thinks the China-Japan War was a bit of a sideshow, I'd like to share a few stats with you. The number of casualties in the war. I've rounded these Wikipedia figures up or down to make them easier to digest, but in the Second World War, total military and civilian deaths combined for just some countries is roughly as follows. Australia, 40,000. Canada, 45,000. France, 600,000. Germany, 7 million. Italy, 500,000. Japan, 3 million. Netherlands, 300,000. Poland, 6 million. UK, 500,000. USA, 400,000. China, 20 million. Soviet Union, 24 million. A big chunk of Soviet Union and China's dead were civilians who died of hunger, but her and the Soviets both still had a huge whack of military deaths compared with the other countries, and the full chart's in the show notes. Just to put those figures in context with COVID, which is going around at the moment. And, do you know, I'll just stop for half a second and I'll apologise for my voice because I'm just recovering from COVID. And it hasn't been too bad, but it was like a grotty cold. But as a result, my vocal cords haven't quite recovered, but I decided I would crack on and get this episode delivered. So if there's been a delay, you now know why. But to put these war dead in context, COVID, the last figure I saw was something like 5 million dead worldwide. Back to the war. After failing to stop the Japanese in the Battle of Wuhan, the Chinese central government was relocated to Chongqing in the Chinese interior. After failing to stop the Japanese in the Battle of Wuhan, the Chinese central government was relocated to Chongqing in the Chinese interior. While Japan ruled the large cities, they lacked sufficient manpower to control China's vast countryside. In November 39, Chinese nationalist forces launched a large-scale winter offensive, while the following August, Chinese communist forces launched a counter-offensive in central China. The United States supported China through a series of boycotts against Japan, leading to cutting off steel and petrol exports to Japan by June 41. Also, American mercenaries such as the Flying Tigers provided extra support to China directly. In December 41, Japan launched a surprise attack on Pearl Harbor and declared war on the United States. The United States declared war in turn and increased its flow of aid to China. With Burma cut off, the US airlifted material over the Himalayas. I want to mention this next review because it's so relevant to the story we're about to cover. It goes as follows. Back as a 17-year-old young man, I went to Dallas, Texas to see the 1978 Rock and Roll 4th of July Texas Jam Concert. I stayed at my best friend's grandparents' house. I'd just read a Time Life World War II book series about flying over the hump to China. Then I found out his grandfather was a pilot flying the Hump. He was so surprised I knew all about it and asked a lot of questions. I could see he was happy and surprised that a young boomer generation appreciated his service and stories. I've just listened to episode 73 and your mention of a lady whose father flew the Hump, and it brought back such a happy memory. Thanks again for bringing back real stories of real heroes of the greatest generation. Now that's from Wolfie Wolf, and Wolfie, you didn't know it, but in writing what you just did, you have given me a great way to introduce this episode, because the lady you just mentioned was Rainy Hovarth, and it was her father's memoirs about flying the Hump. So here we go. What's it all about, Wolfie? In answer to that plea, Rainy Hovarth from just outside of New York wrote to me a while back and said, "I'm American, and my father's memoir is that of an American pilot who nonetheless made friends with other English pilots and soldiers as they fought the same fight. I'd like to share the true story told in his own words of the highly decorated CBI Hump Pilot Robert Binzer, who flew combat transport missions with the 14th Air Force from China, 1943-45. The pilot, Bob Binzer, was my father. He began writing down his war experiences in the 1970s and sending them to me. After his death in 2019, I collected them all and published them as his memoir, The Able Queen, Tales of an Indiana Hump Pilot Lost in the Himalayas. His fascinating account is rare, and Rainy, yes, I agree with you totally there. Now this takes me mysteriously to aluminium. Throughout the episodes for this show, I've had various lessons in pronunciation. We've had the difficulties of sorting out Sheesen from Scheisen, Melbourne and Melbourne, Lieutenant and Lieutenant, and my tonsils have also grappled with Wolfie Wolf and Volkavirum, and there have been others. But now we have Aluminium, as us Brits call it. Rainy herself kindly corrected my pronouncing of that word in the Christmas episode. Of course, the spellings are different, and the American way is aluminum. In the UK, we say aluminium. To celebrate this diversity, I'm going to share a tongue twister my mum once taught me. It's all about a lady, let's say, in 1940, who comes across a man making pans. And the conversation goes like this. "Are you copper-bottoming, my man?" "No, I'm aluminiuming, mum." I'll repeat that. "Are you copper-bottoming, my man?" "No, I'm aluminiuming, mum." I've tried pronouncing it the American way, and I have to say it nearly beat me, but I'll have a go. "Are you copper-bottoming, my man?" "No, I'm aluminiuming, mum." The American way is what we'll use in this show. Fewer syllables, got to be easier. But we've got a stack of Chinese cities coming up in this episode, and no way am I going to succeed with them. But to the best of my knowledge, I haven't got any Chinese listeners, so who's going to tell me off? I will be happy to be corrected, though. But why am I suddenly talking about that light white metal, you may ask? Well, it brings me to the point of the episode. I'll explain. According to Wikipedia, the Hump, as Wolfie just mentioned, was the name given by Allied pilots in the Second World War to the eastern end of the Himalayan mountains, over which they flew military transport aircraft from India to China to resupply the Chinese war effort of Chiang Kai-shek and the units of the United States Army Air Forces, the AAF, based in China. Military author and Hump fan Carl W. Weidenburner in his excellent foreword to this book, said, "They called it the Aluminium Trail. There were so many crashed planes along the route between India and China, they almost created a trail that could be followed from the air. Flying the hump, the route over the Himalayas between India and China, was some of the most dangerous flying in the world. 30,000 foot peaks, unpredictable winds, and Japanese fighters were just some of the perils that awaited flyers. Yet they persevered. The pilots were young, well trained, but not for what awaited them in the skies over the hump. Most of them had signed up to defend their country and for the adventure of piloting their own plane to do so. Robert Dean Binzer was one of these young men, and what follows is his story of adventure in the service of his country. He too would face the perils of the Himalayas and the deadly call of the Aluminium Trail. This is a story that needs to be told, a unique story of the greatest generation. It could be the story of hundreds of young Americans who sought the adventure of flying and found it while serving their country in the far-off China, Burma, India theatre of World War II, the CBI. There you go, you finally know what this episode is all about. And it's feeling very poignant to be doing this episode because Rainy has told me that her dad sadly passed away a year ago in early December, just gone. So what a nice way for us to be commemorating his passing by reading from his memoirs. So here we go. The Able Queen. Memoirs of an Indiana Hump Pilot Lost in the Himalayas by Robert Dean Binzer, as told to Rainy Hovarth. I was born in tiny Waynetown, Indiana, on July the 28th, 1922. At home, which was not uncommon in those days because there was no hospital in town back then and money was scarce. In 1926, my family moved, first to Crawfordsville, Indiana, and then on to Hammond for better job prospects. Jobs were hard to come by then, and better prospects in bigger towns meant that my parents, Elsa and Harry, Doc Binzer, would move again several times to follow work. By 1933, we'd moved to Chicago. Now we rented an apartment building on the corner of 79th and Laughlin Streets, the south side of Chicago. By 1940, Europe was coming apart. Germany was invading and capturing countries left and right, and Russia was afraid there'd be nothing left for them, so they took Finland, Estonia, and more. It seemed pretty obvious to everyone that before long we would become involved in this struggle. In 1940, the draft began. All men in the United States aged 21 to 40 had to register for the draft. This was something new to all of us. I was 17 years old then, but these ages dropped quickly to the all men 18 to 45 bracket. Everyone was amazed to hear that within 12 months they expected to have 900,000 draftees on the lines. Today, many people forget that by the end of World War II, 16 million Americans fought in the war. Of those, 50 million had registered for the draft and 10 million of them had been inducted into service. Nobody could have imagined such a thing as this before then. Everyone was defence-minded, and I was no different, so I purchased an M1 Garand rifle from the Civilian Marksmanship Programme. This was the type of rifle that was widely used in World War II, but I did not have a rifle of this type then, and I wanted to be ready. The M1 Garand was perhaps the finest weapon we had in our arsenal. World War II was won because of our having this weapon, along with some other great equipment, and I'm proud to have one for my very own. By Christmas 1941, we all knew that we'd get involved in the war in Europe sooner rather than later. And I'd turned 18, so I enlisted in the Army Air Corps in April of 1941. As a recruit entering the Air Corps at MacDill Field, Tampa, Florida, in April 41, I had many doubts and fears concerning our ability to fight a war against the Nazis, let alone win it. As for myself, I did not want to wait until the draft called on me, for if that happened, I knew it was very doubtful that I would get a choice in which brand of the service I might be placed, so I went down and enlisted. I had always wanted to fly, and decided on the newly formed Army Air Corps, but I worried that I would not pass the eye test to be a pilot due to some vision problems. Fortunately for me, my dad, Doc Binzer, was an ophthalmologist. He shared my concern and and helped me memorize the eye chart, and I passed with flying colors. I soon found myself in an airbase squadron, and our training would be for running an airbase somewhere else at some time in the future. After a while, we were given some written tests to see what jobs we would qualify for. Eventually, the squadron commander recommended that I should go to the teletype maintenance course at Chanute Field, Illinois. It appeared to me that I'd better take this course to stay in good graces with the squadron commander. And besides, being a teletype mechanic didn't sound like too bad of a job to me at the time, with war looming on the horizon. We soon became acquainted with a teletype machine and were informed that before we left this place, we'd be taking these machines apart and putting them back together blindfolded. This seemed a little far-fetched to me, as there must have been over 1 million parts in this machine. But somehow, I managed to pass the course and ended up rather liking the idea of taking care of teletype machines. Once we'd completed the course, we were to be returned to our squadron, where I'd be doing my new job. Pearl Harbor. Pearl Harbor was a rude awakening for everybody. As I write this on December the 7th, 2006, if someone asked me where I was on this day in 1941 and what my first thoughts were, here is what I'd tell them. I was asleep. It was Sunday and quiet on the New Orleans Army Air Base. Then, out of nowhere, a tremendous herd of sergeants blew through the barracks, awakening everyone who was still asleep. I was told in no uncertain terms to get up, get dressed, and get the teletype machine working as soon, as fast as I could. Then I was told that the Japanese Navy had attacked Pearl Harbor, and we were at war. I nodded my understanding and grabbed my fatigues as I wondered where Pearl Harbor was. We all tried to make sense of it as we jumped into our clothes and wondered how serious this might be. I was certainly not expecting war to come at this point in my military career. I'd been trained in teletype maintenance and was now put in charge of the teletype section of Air Corps Supply, New Orleans Army Air Base. We'd only got one teletype machine at my station in Air Corps Supply, and I managed to get that machine going as soon as I ran into the warehouse where we kept it. Normally this machine was on 8 till 4:30, 5 days a week, but now I was told this machine would be on and working 24 hours each day, every day, 7 days a week. No downtime was acceptable. We kept a folding army cot and some blankets at our station, so I was able to pull the cot up to the machine and sleep whenever there were no messages to send. Incoming messages came in automatically, and all I had to do was acknowledge they'd been received. A bell rang to alert me that it was time to acknowledge receipt of the message. We knew from the radio reports that there was little left of our fleet that had been in the harbour that day. And we also knew that there had been many casualties as a result of this raid by the Japanese Navy. When Pearl Harbor happened, we were far too busy to change jobs. But as the war progressed, the powers that be became aware that we did not have enough pilots to be involved in the war going on in Europe, so they called for more. Eventually, I was accepted into flight training and became a pilot in the Army Air Force. I graduated in advanced flying and Tennessee maneuvers at Brooksfield, San Antonio, Texas in June 1943. These were happy times for me. Training and the thrill of flying left little time to be homesick. It was no secret now that we were boning up for overseas. We spent nights wondering where we'd be sent, talking about the possibilities and wondering how rough it might be. Eventually, a troop train landed us in California and we were loaded onto a large Pacific Ocean luxury liner turned troop ship called the Mariposa. The Mariposa was a beautiful ship with wood-panelled walls and a two-storey high dining room with crystal chandeliers. But that was mostly for the brass. Still, it was a beautiful ship, and if one could forget about the guns and gun crews that were on duty day and night, one might get the feeling that this was just a nice vacation cruise. War was closer now, and by this time we knew what our destination would be. China. We learned that eventually we'd fly over the hump, a 535-mile sky highway over the Himalayan mountains to our air bases somewhere over there. I was one of the pilots on our way to join our squadron, the 19th Liaison Squadron, in Kunming, China. When I found out where I was going, I was eager to get to China. From early adolescence, I'd wanted to visit China, and I usually had a good outlook toward the people there. I arrived at my first base in this outfit, a small airfield northeast of Kunming that had a dirt strip airfield. It was called Yanglin, and here we were a constant target for the Japanese bombers. The barracks had been built by the local peasants by hand, using bricks made with clay and straw. The barracks had red tile roofs and charcoal-burning heaters, and we did have doors, which most houses in China did not have back then. There were many dangers we faced in flying the hump. Getting over the Himalayan mountains, of course, the unpredictable weather, as the Himalayan mountains create their own weather systems, and a lack of communications to start with, and, of course, the Japanese enemy. But there were other problems as well, disease and dysentery, and the fact that not all the natives were friendly. Paoshan. Paoshan was a particularly dangerous area because it was headquarters for Chiang Kai-shek's private forces. So it was always a target for Japanese bombers, even though it was just a grass airfield in a valley between two steep mountains, with the Salween River running just a couple of blocks away from the centre of town. There were 8 enlisted pilots in this squadron, and we flew Stinson L-5 Sentinels. These were small and manoeuvrable enough to land in tight jungle airstrips, but large enough to carry roughly 3.3 tons of equipment and supplies and evacuate wounded patients. We were also an observation and reconnaissance squad, so that was another reason for the Japanese to go after us. We had other ships too, but mostly we flew the L-5s. We were given missions to deliver bombs and gasoline to one of 2 airfields that were surrounded by the Japanese, and we could only get in there with a fighter escort. These missions were to be during daylight hours. We had to fly in close formation, one time so close that we waved to each other. The fighters would go ahead of us, supposedly clearing the way, and it worked. We got to the surrounded airfields, made our delivery without being fired on, but because of the constant danger of Japanese bombers, it was decided that future missions to those airfields would be at night, and with no lights or radios. We'd already done several missions like this, and they worked. However, there were other problems with flying at night, One was the Japanese air raids. Our fighters were able to provide air cover to us during daytime operations, but not at night. So when we flew night missions, we were on our own. This tends to sharpen the flying skills. Troop Carrier, Mission 5. Or Up a River Without a Tail, November the 13th, 1944. We were transporting mail up from Yunnani back to Chungking. On board was our crew, Crew Chief Sergeant Clifford Spielberg and Radio Operator Sergeant Bob O'Mara. Weather was routine. We were on top above the clouds, flying at about 12,000 feet, and the weather at Pai Shi Yi Airfield was reported as overcast, with reported visibility 1 mile. We were letting down over the Pai Shi Yi beacon when a strange voice came on the frequency announcing, "American dog! American dog!" We realised that we'd picked up another station on the Pai Shi Yi Airfield frequency, a station we did not want to be on. Did they know we were there? But breaking out of the overcast, we could not see the field directly below us as we should have. Maybe it was a visibility problem. Visibility was the half mile or less. This was the worst case of stupidity, or we weren't sure what else. It was probably the fog on top, but in any case, conditions were such that we would have to let down or land at Pai Shi Yi on instruments. Letting down on instruments, the worst that can be imagined. But wait, this is not all the problems at this base. Here we not only had very poor letdown procedure, but we also had the Japanese harassing us on our letdown frequency. So we didn't know if they had somehow screwed up the letdown direction signal or worse. Finally, we could see the field below and realised that visibility was not 1 mile as we'd been told, but closer to quarter mile due to dense fog in the valley. We had some trouble finding the runway, but arrived at our destination in spite of the clandestine radio signals. Filed away for future reference. 1. Beacon at Pai Shi Yi unreliable due to enemy intervention. And 2. Weather reporting not accurate. Listener, there are no end of adventures in this book, and I'm going to give you a preview of some of them later. But for now, here is the story of the Able Queen herself. She was a brand new C-47B that we had to abandon one dark and cold night in February 1945. Our destination was Chi Chang, a sort of jumping-off base. Bombers and fighters were based there, and our job was to help keep the base supplied with gasoline, ammunition and other supplies, like parts, and just about anything we could carry in a C-47. We had made many of these trips to the east now, because the enemy had been driven out of the western part of China, and we were no longer needed to support the ground troops there. Now it was time for us to concentrate on the eastern and southeastern parts of China. Chi Chang was important because it wasn't surrounded by the enemy, as were the bases out east. But going to and from Chi Chang was not a real sweat deal like the others. The weather in the winter there was tricky. From the Chi Chang base, we would occasionally fly on to one of two or three bases in the southeast of China, taking the same sort of supplies to them. The only problem was that these bases were located in the part of China that had very recently been occupied by the Japanese enemy. But with the aid of the Chinese guerrillas, we were able to keep these bases in operation. Fighters would land, top off their tanks, take on ammo or bombs, and get right back out to the coast, and or Formosa, to strike the shipping or other targets. On the way home, they would stop there again, and get enough fuel to return to their bases. We had no weather service, as we have today. In fact, there were pitifully few real weather stations in the whole of China. So there was always a concern about the weather, no matter where you flew. To make matters worse, due to the shortage of gasoline, we were only allowed enough fuel to get there and get back home with 20 or 30 minutes of reserve in your tanks. Our ship, the Able Queen, was not the original ship of that name. This was a new aircraft, more or less, brought in with replacements for lost planes that we'd received into the squadron. This was a C-47B Skytrain, equipped with two-stage blower superchargers. That's the only way we could have made it to 22,000 feet. Pilot discretion could often be used to request extra fuel if reasonable need could be established, but sometimes that was a real hassle. Needless to say, this situation sharpened your skills at navigation immeasurably. These were the conditions we had to deal with while in China at that time. Our mission today was to take a load of gasoline to Qichang and return to Chongqing. No problem. Our crew was field engineer George Youngling, radio operator Dan Anderson, co-pilot Warren C. Elliott, pilot myself, Bob Binzer. Weather in February 1945 was not the best, but I don't recall any great concern about the weather as we departed. It was up on top, and away we go. Checkpoint came up ahead of schedule, and the beacon at our destination, Qichang, was loud and clear. We landed in fairly good weather, but to beat the weather for the return journey, we had to move fast. So instead of going to the mess hall as we'd usually done, we decided to stay with the ship and ask for full fuel on our trip back because the headwinds were strong. While refueling, Warren and I ran to the local diner, the McDonald's of the day, which was not McDonald's at all, for some hamburgers to save time as we wanted to get ahead of that weather that we felt was developing. We'd requested full tanks, which was asking a lot and required special permission. But we knew we had headwinds to fight on our return and faced the possibility of some icing in the clouds. Not too many days prior to this trip, we'd lost two aircraft and crews due to icing conditions. So we knew that it was possible to encounter icing and that our C-47 could not handle it. I determined to avoid icing if it was at all possible. So we stared above the clouds as we started our trip home. While Warren and I went up the street for the food and ate, George stayed behind and took care of the fuel. We brought food back for him, but when we came back with his food, we found that we'd been refused additional gasoline. After much hassle, they reluctantly allowed us more fuel, but only after the base commander okayed our request, because he too realised that the winds were building up. Finally, we were off for points west. I think we were going back to Kunming, perhaps to Chongqing. I can't really recall where now, but by now we had weather, so we climbed to the top. It took a long time, and we topped out at perhaps 16 or 18,000 feet. The cloud tops continued to build, and we ended up at 20,000, and then finally at 22,000 to get above the weather. We'd been on oxygen for some time now, but for the first hour, I was not concerned. We would check our checkpoint off to the north, to Giyang. It was soon dark, and it took a long time to reach our radio checkpoint at Kuaiyang. It appeared off our right wing, as it should have. However, this went on for another hour. Our radio indicated that we were on course to Chongqing, which was our base north of Kunming. Again, we checked on the ADF, and Kuaiyang was still at 90 degrees. This was not good, because it should now be indicating behind that point at perhaps 100 or 115 degrees. This went on for many hours trying to reach Kunming. We had reduced our power setting to a minimum flow to conserve gasoline and stay in the air as long as possible. But this also reduced our forward track, if there was any forward track at all. We had flown out our ETA, and kept getting higher and higher. Listener, that means they were overdue. They had a transport schedule to keep, but there was no radar as we know it today, so nobody was really looking for them yet. They realised that they should have reached their destination already, but it was not in sight, and the weather conditions made them continue to climb. They just knew something was wrong. And if the headwind was greater than their maximum speed, then in relation to the ground, they wouldn't be making any headway. They'd be going backwards. Hence the term forward track, or lack of it. Now we were still on oxygen to stay above the weather, and we were getting more than a little concerned. At this point, I began to doubt our checkpoint, but Kunming Beacon and Chi Chang Beacon were still providing the proper bearings, so we continued to bore on through the night. It was about 5 p.m. when we left Chi Chang, so we'd been in the dark for quite a while now, with checkpoints still showing as before. There had to be something wrong with the automatic direction finder, the ADF, for the station north of us, we thought. But we were really standing still as far as forward progress goes, although we really had no way to determine this back then. All of this happened in the days before much was known about the jet stream. We were not used to flying at this altitude, so we had no real experience with the jet stream. We didn't know that the jet stream had lowered now and was straight into us at 170 miles an hour, which at times gave us a zero ground speed. We had no way to measure it or knowledge of it. By now, we'd reached our ETA for the Kunming area and still had no significant change in our ADF response. We confirmed our suspicions that we were possibly in big trouble, so I asked Dan to request a bearing from a ground station, indicating that we were uncertain as to our location at this time. Had we been aware of what was happening, we could have returned to Chi Chang and landed, but we certainly would not then have had this story to tell. In addition, it was almost unheard of to scrub a mission due to winds. In this case, we would have been forgiven, but people seldom believe the truth when a mission is scrubbed, unless they too had been in that same weather. The weather below was not good, and I don't recall our ever getting a bearing or any help from the ground station. We had been in the air now nearly 8 or 9 hours, flying on about 6 hours of fuel. Finally, we realised that we would have to abandon ship and started making preparations before our final fuel ran out. Secret codes were destroyed. All charts having radio frequencies were destroyed. George had now reached the point of great concern. He was afraid that we were over Lake Kunming and that we would drown upon hitting the water. I did not think we were near Lake Kunming. However, I did not know where we were, and I could not see what difference it would make if we made a turn back to the east for a few minutes, as George had requested. We reported this back to the ground station, and they were concerned that we would go screaming on east with this tailwind and wind up in enemy territory. Later, we learned that the ground stations were able to hear us, but we could not hear them. So I turned east while everyone else on board began getting ready to go. We knew what was supposed to be in our parachute backpack, but often there could be something missing, and none of us had our very own parachute. We were using the parachutes that had been loaded on the airplane by someone else for our mission. Warren and I began tearing up any papers that might be useful to the enemy. The little pieces we slipped out of a window, piece by piece. This didn't take too long. We took a chart of the area that we were supposed to be in, and we had a Thompson machine gun with a case of ammo, but no one wanted to take the machine gun along with them. I certainly did not. I decided to take all the medical supplies we could handle, and Andy and Warren took the flashlights and any food we had. We had no choice but to bail out of this nice new airplane. Dan radioed that we were about to abandon ship. It was not until later that I found out that he had gotten no confirmation of his message from our operations office back at Yunani. But it wouldn't have mattered anyway, because it was time to go. Now. No one seemed to be eager to be the first one. The jump door panel was removed, and it was time to jump. We agreed to go out together, one after another, as close as possible, so we might land near one another. The first one that was able was to build a bonfire for a rendezvous point. The ship was on autopilot, geared down with quarter flaps to be slower for our jumping out, all lights on. Perhaps, I thought, to enable someone to avoid the inevitable crash. No one was eager to be the first to leave. Finally, I mentioned that someone had to go, now. Suddenly, George, our crew chief, got up and bolted out of the door, pulling his ripcord as soon as he reached the doorway. His chute opened and blew him back into the doorway, nearly to the door of the toilet. And then George was gone, his chute quickly following him out of the door, except for the last little bit which caught and trailed out the jump door. Oh, poor George! A piece had caught and was fluttering in the wind. A piece had ripped away from his chute. This was a disaster, as it would seem. George would be injured or killed due to some of the parachute being missing. Oh, God, please help him. To see him pulling his ripcord as soon as he reached the doorway was a shock. It was unbelievable. George was gone, a piece of his parachute ripped away. I hollered to the rest to make damn sure they were out of the door before they pulled the ripcord. The plane was now on autopilot. We could run out of fuel at any moment. We quickly agreed that one must be out and away from the aircraft before pulling the ripcord. Dan got to the door next and asked for a push as he went out, which I did. Then Warren Elliott had to go. He also asked for the push, which I half-heartedly did, as I was not sure at all that my push was any guarantee of getting him past the tail. Then myself. Only there was no one left to push me out, but it was now or never. Go! A push was not needed, of course, and I jumped clear and was falling, tumbling through the pitch-black night. I realised that I must now pull on that ripcord and get on with this business of surviving. When I was certain I was clear of the ship, I pulled the cord, and much to my relief, the parachute worked as it should have. There was a welcome jolt. I thanked God for whatever help he'd given me on that score. We left our ship on top and were soon in the clouds below, which we discovered was freezing rain that we went through. My first recollection, it seems now, was the profound silence that was about me. After thanking the Lord, I looked around. I could see the lights of our ship heading off in the distance, as both engines still had some fuel left. While quietly floating down to the cloud's deck below, I watched the Able Queen disappear until I could no longer see her. I was sick about losing our beautiful Able Queen. However, the excitement at hand helped to keep this in the background of my mind for the time. We were coming down in a valley about 150 miles south of Kwai Yang. It was very dark below. I must have been in the clouds now, for I could see nothing at all. Then I was aware that I was between two layers of clouds, and I couldn't believe how quiet it was. There was no sensation of going down, just a slight swinging effect. At this time, I remembered that I should cross my ankles, as I had been taught, in case I came down across a fence or something. I crossed my ankles and peered down into the blackness below, remembering what I was taught about controlling oscillation on the way down. Before long, I was out of the clouds and could see more as I peered down into the blackness below me, hoping to see on what or where I might be landing. The darkness grew blacker and blacker, and then, wham! I was on the ground, and I didn't seem to be hurt. Again, I gave thanks. I still had that ripcord in my hand. I don't know why you're not supposed to hold on to that thing, but for some reason I still gripped it. It was a surprise to me. I really expected the trip to the ground to last a little longer, but there I was. I realised my parachute was in a small tree of some kind, and I lay there for what seemed to be a long time, just looking around, realising that I was not injured, and again giving thanks for that. But there was nothing to see. It was very dark and perhaps foggy. My chute was caught in this small tree, and I still lay there, quiet, listening for anything that might be about, but hearing nothing. I pulled out my 45 and threw a shell into the chamber, then replaced it into the shoulder holster. At the same time, I said, but not too loudly, "Megwafeege! Megwafeege Bing!" meaning, "I'm an American airman. I'm an American airman soldier." No answer. We really had no idea where we were, or if we were even in friendly territory. Then I got up and wrestled my chute down out of the tree and balled it up under my arm as best I could. I put on my cap that had been tucked inside my flight jacket and looked around. It was pitch black now. I had no flashlight and freezing rain was falling, so I decided to start walking. I took about 6 to 8 steps forward and suddenly, wham! I dropped about 4 or 5 feet into a rice paddy, perhaps. I never found out. This scared the living daylights out of me. I had not expected it, so now I became more cautious. I realised that I was out in the freezing rain and my jacket was starting to get iced over. I got up and started walking downhill and started hollering for Warren or Dan, since they should have been the closest ones to me. Pretty soon, I heard someone yelling faintly in the distance, and I answered them back. I couldn't tell who it was yet, but I started off in that direction and kept walking and yelling until I could hear him better. As we closed in on one another, I finally heard that it was Warren. Was I ever glad! So finally, Warren, my co-pilot, and I found each other, and it was a great relief for us both. Warren was okay too, and said he had passed a house up the way, and that maybe we should go back up there and see if they would let us in out of the cold weather, and perhaps try to find out where we had landed. I followed him, and he led me back up the path to where he had found a little house. The door was not a door as we know it, but a bamboo screen-like affair stretched across a doorway that was open at the top and at the bottom. We knocked on the partition and tried our Chinese, mentioning that we were Megwafeege, Megwafeege, but we heard nothing, no response. Warren shined his flashlight in, and what we saw was really scary. The family that lived there was plastered against the far wall, eyes wide open, and with the most frightful look frozen on their faces that I had ever seen. They were scared to death of us and were in a complete shock. It was apparent right away that we were not going to make friends with this family under the present conditions. We realised that they did not understand us and were afraid to come to the door. So we decided to leave them alone, as we were afraid that in their frightened condition they might fire a gun or something else for protection. So, back into the freezing rain and down the path we went. What to do now? Well, I had noticed a stack of hay around a pole back down the path that Warren had found. We decided to go down and start a bonfire so the others might find us, as we had planned. We set up one of the parachutes to cover our backs as a shelter and pulled some hay from the stack. Using matches from our survival packs, we got the fire going in front of us. It must have been cold, as it had been freezing the rain that had fallen. However, I do not recall being cold. Regardless, the fire felt good and warmed our hands as we watched for someone to come to us and hoped there would be friendlies. We let the fire get fairly large and kept watch for the others as far as we could see downhill in the dark. Talking it over, we figured that I had landed farther up on this hill from where we were at that time, and that Warren must have landed not far from that house, back up the way behind that. So it seemed logical that Dan, our radio operator, must have landed somewhere down below. George, our crew chief, landed somewhere even farther down that lane. Poor George, we really worried about him because of what we'd witnessed as he went out of that door. He couldn't possibly have landed easily as I had done. Most likely his was a very hard landing. We continued to watch and feed the fire from the stack behind us. After about an hour, I thought I saw a light, very briefly. Warren had seen it too, but then it disappeared again. We both thought we saw glimpses of a flashlight down below us. Being concerned about who it might be, I figured one of us should get the 45 out. I asked Warren to go up on a rise behind us and cover us with his 45 until we could see who was coming up the hill. Warren said, "No way, I can't hit the side of a barn with this thing. You go up there and cover me." Okay. So I went up in the tall grass behind where we'd been and laid down with my 45 at the ready. We stayed that way for quite a while, with me laying on the ground about 10 or 20 feet uphill and behind Warren. Whoever it was, they were headed in our direction. Suddenly, about 1:30 or 2 a.m, here came Dan, flashing his light at us and letting us know it was him. We were so glad to see him. He told us that he'd been watching us too, but was cautious about walking up there without knowing who was sitting at that fire. We kept the fire going and wondered what had become of George. We decided it was best to wait until daylight to start looking for him. So now there were three of us feeding the fire and watching downhill. This we did until it was starting to get light enough to where you could see where you were going. But then it began to snow again, heavier than before. As soon as it was light enough to leave, we put out the fire and started down the path in the snow, going down the one that Dan had approached us on. We reasoned that George was somewhere out in that direction and could see another roadway farther down the valley, so we followed the path we were on toward the other road. Dan pointed to the area where he felt he had landed. We decided that I had landed between Warren and Dan, and that George was somewhere below us, where that small roadway was. Warren, being lighter weight, must have drifted farther up the slope of this mountain. We covered the ground pretty fast going downhill, and could see now that there was a roadway of some type beyond. As the path reached the roadway, we saw a small shack of some kind with three walls being open on the side toward the path. Inside, a lady was preparing food in what looked like a small dugout log of some kind. She had a short pole and was beating and kneading a dough of some sort, something that looked like mashed potatoes but was most likely rice. The lady was friendly and greeted us with smiles and gestures, indicating that we should come inside the building. She didn't interrupt her work or seem to be the least bit afraid of us. She still seemed friendly as we began trying to inquire and converse with her, using our pointy talk book that had sentences in English on one side and the Chinese meaning written just opposite. But this was not working at all, for she clearly did not read Chinese. Not understanding anything we pointed to, she still smiled very graciously, nodded and offered us some food. We kindly refused the offer of food, as we had no idea what it was or how it might affect our system, but we tried to find out which way we should go to find the nearest village. She seemed to understand and indicated to our right or up the valley. We tried to thank her as best we could and headed up the road. It was snowing hard by now, and it was beginning to be a fairly good snow, with large flakes but no wind. We looked down the roadway again for any sign of George being down that road, but not a soul was to be seen. So we started our walk up this roadway, which was an unpaved, unimproved, wide mountain path. The snowfall got heavier now. The flakes were so large. Luckily, the wind was very slight, so we were able to easily walk up the dirt road, crunching the fresh snow under our boots. We had been walking for about an hour or so. I'm not sure how long it was we walked before we realised that there were people following us. Behind us, there were at least 40 to 50 Chinese, mostly young people and children, following. They were so curious and aghast of these strange-looking people moving through their land. Silent, reserved and wide-eyed, they followed closely behind us. Some of the younger ones pointed to our shoes, especially my size 13 paratrooper boots that were crunching through the snow, leaving tracks. They were extremely curious and kept pointing at my boots, trying to hide laughing at me. At least they seemed friendly enough, not like headhunters. So up the roadway we all went through the snow, us ahead and them following behind. After maybe an hour or so on the road, we began to see signs of a village, and the crowd following behind us had grown even larger than before. For some reason, I turned around to look behind us and was astonished to see at least 200 to 300 people following behind us now. Each had the most curious look about them. We figured that we must be the first foreigners they'd ever seen in this remote area. Now we began to recognise the outskirts of a village on either side of the road. Finally, we reached what must have been the centre of the village, where we saw some sort of a reception committee standing in front of a building flying the Chinese flag. What a relief! It was very reassuring to us, because we still had no idea where we were or who these people were. But what a relief to see the Chinese and not the Japanese flag flying. The natives were friendly enough, though, so we weren't scared, that I can recall. Anxious, yes, and we were concerned about George, but we were not afraid of these natives. It so happened that they were having a funeral at the same time. The whole town had turned out. In Chinese funerals, they carry the body down the street and throw firecrackers on top of the coffin to scare off the evil spirits. While all this was going on, a lady offered us some local food, but we didn't know what it was and declined it. Then she offered us a bowl of navel oranges covered by a white powder. We didn't know what the powder was, but we were hungry, so we took them and ate and asked for more. They brought out a couple more, which we three split. Later, we found out that only the wealthiest people could have afforded oranges like these in the dead of winter, because they came from occupied territory in the north, and they'd been preserved for several months with this white powder. We walked on and stopped in front of the person who was the most dressed up of anyone there to greet them. He had a man with him, who we guessed was a Chinese army official from his uniform. They were both standing out in front of the biggest building in town that flew a flag. They invited us into their building. We entered and attempted to explain our situation and discuss our desires. No one there understood us, and nobody there spoke English. We pulled out the pointy talkie books that we carried in our survival packs. These were small booklets with English-Chinese translations that were issued to airmen in case of bailout, but nobody there was able to read the Chinese printed in the booklets. They didn't even recognise the Chinese flag. Still, through gestures and drawings, we talked about our lost crew chief and pantomimed that he may have been injured and was out there in the snow somewhere. Again, we tried to use the pointy talkie books to communicate, and now they seemed to help a little. However, the dialect in our books didn't appear to be a dialect that these people were used to. Finally, the mayor of the village appeared at the building to greet us, and he seemed to understand our plight. He had a man with him who spoke a few words of English. We learned that there was a telephone in the building, an old hand-crank telephone like we used to have in the US in the 20s and 30s. The man told us they were getting an interpreter on the phone. We found that attempting to talk to someone on their phone was nearly impossible. Nevertheless, I did feel that we were told that an English interpreter was on his way to us and would arrive in a few hours to help. In the meantime, the mayor offered to show us around town. First, he took us to his house, which was quite large, and wanted us to meet his family too and show us all the conveniences he had. Of everything I was shown, he was most proud of their bedroom set. It was of a Western design and quite nice. After showing us his home and the rest of the village, we went back to the army post to get some rest. We were shown that there was one bunk there, and it was indicated that we could share it in shifts. They insisted that I go first, as I was the ranking officer. They must have had a book showing the rank of each American soldier. I accepted and tried to sleep. I guess I did, for soon I was awakened as the interpreter had arrived. There was much commotion and protocol and formal introductions all around. But the interpreter was not exactly what we'd expected. His English was hopeless. In the meantime, George was out there somewhere and we had to find him. This was explained to the interpreter as well as we could and to all of those present, and the interpreter spoke to the others for us. Now things started happening quickly. We were told through the interpreter that they would all help us to look for George. The whole village turned out to help, it seems. We could see that they were ready to go out and help us in our search, and we all left together. As we approached the outskirts of the area that we had planned to search, I suggested that we break up into three groups. I cannot now recall my reasons, but I had Dan take the main road with the village chiefs, while Warren took his group of perhaps 60 villagers up to the left side of the small valley that we were in. Dan stayed on the roadway with the interpreter, and I took another group and scattered them out along the right side of the valley, following the ridge of a hill to the south in our search area. Warren took another group off the opposite side of the road and followed the ridge on that side of the valley, as we proceeded slowly toward where we concluded George might have landed. We spread out in a fashion to cover the area better, and were on this effort now about an hour or so. We'd not been travelling too long when there was a great commotion on the roadway, and we were all waved to come down to the road to where Dan was with his group. We went immediately. There was much commotion and protocol, for the interpreter had been inquiring of the travellers on the road about seeing anything of our missing airmen. There was much excitement as the searchers discovered that, yes indeed, someone had found George on the roadway the night before and had taken him home with them to spend the night. They would be bringing him to us this day. What good news, even though we could not yet understand if George was injured or not. It seemed he'd spent the night with the people who'd found him and took him into their home, and they would bring him to us that afternoon in the village. Wow! George must be okay, we thought, as they did not mention anything about injuries that we could determine. Wonderful news! And now we all headed back to the village to wait for George to be with us. We returned to the Chinese army outpost and rested in shifts until later that afternoon when George arrived. Meanwhile, in the Chinese army outpost building, a man started boiling water in a wok. He put something that looked like lard on the surface and was about to break an egg on it, but I was afraid this would not be too sanitary for us. I explained as best I could that we would like to put the egg into the boiling water and let it get hard inside instead. He did not understand, I am sure, but he agreed, and pretty soon we had some hard boiled eggs to eat. There must have been something else to go with the eggs, but I cannot recall right now what it was. But my, those boiled eggs tasted mighty good. George arrived. We listened to his story about the people finding him and taking him home and bedding him down with them. The Chinese slept all in one bed, toe to toe, and they put him into that bed with them. He appeared to be okay until we told him about his parachute being damaged. He'd not realised this happened and quickly inspected his chute. When he saw that there was a piece missing, he looked a little pale, and after that he was more subdued than before. I'm sure he now realised how close to death he had been. We asked our interpreter to notify our squadron, and we were all now in one group and not injured. I was not sure how long the army waited before sending an MIA report to our relatives missing in action, but now that we were together again, it was only a question of how we would get back to our base, wherever that was. Riding with the Chinese Army. We were informed that a Chinese army truck was about to leave for the large city to the north of us, and we could ride on that truck as far as we wished. The truck was probably a 5 or 6 tonner that was loaded at least to 8 tons of assorted freight, which was hanging over the side rails. It was their typical charcoal burner type vehicle that would be started on rice alcohol. Then, after it was underway, the methane gas from the charcoal burner would kick in and the alcohol would be shut off. Or listen, I guess in the words of Brian Moss in the previous episode, otherwise dealt with. On hills, it seemed to me, the alcohol would have to be added again to get us up the hills. We were in a mountainous area. My recollection is that the cab of the truck was only large enough to hold the driver and two of us, so someone had to ride on top of this mess. It was cold, and the rugs or covering of some kind that were used to help ward off the wind and chill on the outdoor passengers didn't help much. I believe we exchanged places at some point, so that we each had a turn at riding in the comfort of the drafty truck cab. My memory says we drove all night and into the next day before we came to a place to spend the night. The sights we saw were beautiful, even in the cloudy, sometimes windy weather. We saw strange-looking mountains like ice cream cones turned upside down, poking up into the cloudy sky. It was incredibly beautiful country, but due to the weather, it was a dismal ride all the way, in spite of the great scenery. It snowed some more on occasion as well. I recall that we were on the road about 3 nights before reaching Kwai Yang, which was the large town to the north, where they were headed. One of these nights we stayed with some of our own troops. They were either OSS or some of the graves and record companies that go in to retrieve deceased crews from the wrecks. But on one of the other nights, we stayed at a Chinese outpost of some size. There were some American soldiers attached to this unit, it seems. Listener, the OSS was the Office of Strategic Services, kind of intelligence agency. Gombe. We arrived at a Chinese army outpost, and after we had located our sleeping quarters and cleaned up, we were invited up to the second or third floor of this large Chinese-style building. This turned out to be a large dining hall with possibly 4 big round tables, tablecloths on and all. We were treated like heroes of some sort, although I certainly did not feel anything like a hero after losing a brand new C-47. But a toast was in order. They toasted us. Gombe! This means bottoms up. They'd placed small ceramic shot glasses, like tiny cups, filled with rice whiskey in front of us. There were speeches made in Chinese, and someone tried to translate for us in English what had been said. Basically, it was, "Welcome, and thank you, Americans, for helping us in this war effort." Then it was more, "Gombe," and I don't think that any of us were feeling any pain at that point. and then the food started coming. In the centre of the room, on a lazy Susan, was a large round tray with a charcoal fire burning at the centre. There were perhaps 7 or 8 compartments, and we were told that all of these were rice dishes, each prepared in a different manner. They all tasted wonderful. Some had prunes, some had oranges, some were sweet, some sour. All were delicious, or at least in my condition at the time, I thought everything was delicious. All through the meal, the gombe cups were kept filled. I found out that all we had to do was turn our cups over and they would stop filling them. But at any rate, we were treated very graciously and treated to a very delicious banquet. This was a very pleasant and unexpected surprise given our circumstances and all the things that could have happened. We'll leave Bob's story there. Plenty more where that came from. You'll need to buy Rainy's book to find out what happened next. More on that later. Cue Wikipedia again. Few stats here. The India-China airlift delivered approximately 650,000 tons of material to China at great cost in men and aircraft during its 42-month history. For its efforts and sacrifices, the India-China Wing of the Air Transport Command was awarded the Presidential Unit Citation on 22nd of January 44 at the personal direction of President Franklin D. Roosevelt, the first such award made to a non-combat organisation. Robert Hovarth was awarded certain military decorations as follows. Air Medal with 2 oak leaf clusters. Distinguished Flying Cross with 1 oak leaf cluster. Asiatic Pacific Theatre Ribbon with 1 bronze star. American Defence Ribbon. And the China War Memorial Medal. What a great adventure. That was strange, almost surreal, because we're not used to hearing about good political relations between us and China. But what a nice feeling that story leaves. There's plenty more where that came from if you want to read the book. I'm just going to share with you now a few teasers to give you a feel for what action remains in the book. We pilots and even crew members realised we were most likely around snow-covered Mount Darley, and if we were much beyond that, we could possibly be over Lolo country. We knew the Lolos were noted for cannibalism. A fine kettle of fish we'd be in if we were caught by them. I was to fly the airplane over at 500 feet. The gear installed was an electronic receiver and with a 4-foot parabolic antenna underneath to see if it would be able to detect that an atomic bomb had been detonated underground. As we approached Sichuan one night, the call went out, Jingbao, air raid, go northeast and circle. Fine. Remember, we're now using the fuel intended for our return trip. Remember how dark it is out there, and that there are many other C-47s out there too, with no lights and no radio, at the same time we were. Now it was sweat time. It all happened so fast. Al tried to go under the cables and we missed all but one, but suddenly we hit something and all hell broke loose. The plexiglass navigator's dome was smashed and Al calmly commented, no rudder, and wrestled for control of the plane. We could not turn now and there were huge mountains all around us. What a heaven we found when we stepped off that plane. The good old USA. The Red Cross ladies were there to greet us with real stateside milk and cookies and donuts. Nothing ever tasted better. It was a clear day, and you could see forever as we were letting down into the valley below. Looking down, I spotted a crashed B-29 down in a rice paddy. Then I spotted another, and another. I pointed them out, and we all looked. Below us, we could see perhaps 8 or 9 B-29s scattered all over the valley floor. One glance at the airfield below, where we were to land, and we counted 4 more. The right engine suddenly started losing power and became very rough, sputtering. I stepped up to the cockpit doorway and looked in to see what the situation was. The crew was madly doing all the things they possibly could do to get the engine running again. I could smell the alcohol used to de-ice the carburetor and watched the crew attempting to restart the engine. A C-46 at this altitude, unloaded as we seem to be, does not hold altitude on a single engine for very long. Oof, my word, is all I can say. There are several heartwarming reflections by Rainy towards the end of this book, and they include the following lovely passage. Flying without fear requires faith in 3 things: your pilot, your aircraft, and your God. Trusting your pilot is a legacy I inherited from my father. Even though my parents divorced, he made sure I knew the thrill of flight. On divorced dad visit days, he picked me up, ostensibly to go to the park, but really, we drove to a local airport where he rented a small plane from the flying school and taught me how to fly. Climbing and banking, swooping and soaring, he explained the importance of updrafts and downdrafts and how dial and lever worked, peppering his lessons with examples from his war days of how this dial or that lever almost cost them. I learned if you understand your aircraft, there's nothing at all to fear up in flight. The highlight of each lesson was when Dad turned the controls over to me. I never felt more important than gripping the yoke and steering. Having such confidence placed in me was pretty heady stuff for an almost 8-year-old. "Look at you, you're flying a plane," he'd brag. "Then take over to show me how to land. Better not mention this to your mom, though. She might not like it." No kidding. My favourite reflection on this adventure was how Robert Hovarth himself summed up his experience. "We were lost in an area so remote at that time that they didn't even know the Chinese flag and could not read their own country's language, as was written on our flags. Only one person in that village had some knowledge of written language, and he was the mayor." I guess what I need to say at this point is that I don't know of any families I could identify there to go back now and search for. It would be a fantastic trip back down this valley to find them and thank those people who helped us when we were down and out, and maybe bring them a little gift. But heaven only knows who or where those people are today. So we all made it back in one piece, and this ends my story of being lost in a remote, mountainous area of China. I'll never forget the 15 months I spent inside that scenic country, helping them fight their enemy and trying to keep my crew safe. It is a good story because of how it ended. It could have ended a lot differently. However, the real story, I feel, is not about soldiers and battles, but the real story lives somewhere out there in the boondocks, where the real people are. No politics, no games, just nice people who go out of their way to help you. Rainy, thank you for your efforts in bringing your dad's story into the public domain and for your support to me in airing this episode. Well done, that girl. It isn't one of these flashy big budget book launch affairs. This is the daughter, Rainy, doing her own thing like I did. So please, give your best fighting through support for a great story. The book has 155 pages on paperback or ebook, and you can get it from Amazon, Barnes & Noble, Kobo, Ingram, and other fine booksellers. So that's The Able Queen, Tales of an Indiana Hump Pilot Lost in the Himalayas by Rainy Hovarth. That's Hovarth. After all this, I managed to get Rainy on a Zoom conference for a short chat about the book, how she went about getting it published, etc. And here she goes. Let me start off with how you decided to publish your dad's book. Because what happened first?
Well, my father was always telling his stories from the time I was a small child. I remember being, you know, at barbecues with him or parties, and pretty soon all the men would be off over in a corner and my dad would be in the center of the circle and he would be telling his stories.
Yeah.
And, you know, he told them orally for a long time, but then I would say toward the end of the 60s, after maybe he, you know, settled down a little bit and got a typewriter, he started writing up some of the episodes. Then he sent them to family. So he'd say, you know, I just want you to know this story that happened to me. Yes. And over the years, as the decades went on, I had a whole file drawer with his individual snippets of stories in them.
Yeah.
That he had just thought up or told. But he very much went to every reunion. He went to air shows and, you know, he kept in touch with people he was in the war with. We went and visited them and stuff like that. So he was always kind of reliving those stories. As he got older, he began to try and publish them. And so he never really had any success with it. You know, he was trying to work and run a house and family, and publishing wasn't his thing. After he died, in my last visit with him, I was actually looking for something else in his file drawer. And I ran across this memoir that he had written. And I had no idea, and no one else knew he had actually sat down and written this whole thing toward the end of his life. And so after he died, I asked him if I could have a copy, and he said yes. And then I started looking at it, and I was like, this is fascinating. So I asked him, Dad, do you want me to publish this? And do you want me to put your other stories in it? And he said yes. And then shortly thereafter, he died. So I figured it was the last promise I made to my father, and yeah, I was going to keep it, you know? So I did it. And so it became a very fascinating project for me.
It must have been a fun journey, because I know I found it hugely rewarding doing Dad's book.
It was absolutely fascinating. I had no idea how interested in it I would become and what a fascinating topic. Of course, he was in the CBI Theatre of War in China.
Yeah.
But when I started looking into it and finding out the amount of human, you know, effort and suffering and fortitude that went in from all the forces, all of the forces. I read about the Burma Road and the Allies and India and China, and started watching movies and reading books. And I sort of became fascinated with the whole CBI Theater of War. And his story, I realized, was one small part of it.
Yeah.
So, I'm still fascinated with it.
It's an important part of the war in the sense that it's so easily forgotten, because it doesn't normally figure in, you know, in the movies or the general chit chat that you see in the internet forums. It doesn't figure as an area that people are hugely interested in, and it's not because it's not interesting, it's just that people are ignorant about it.
I would agree with that. I think it was probably the smallest theater of war, yeah, maybe, and I know it was the least money spent on it and probably the least soldiers killed, but you know, all of the action was in Europe.
Yeah.
And my father was surprised when he went to China. When they sent him away to air base school, he was sent to a bomber pilot training. He assumed he would be a bomber. That's where he started.
Yeah.
And it didn't end up that way. So, so he ended up in China, and for which I'm kind of glad, because who knows if he would have made it.
Oh gosh. Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
But he loved it. He loved flying and he loved his service.
Well, he had some great adventures, and I just love your book.
Thank you. I've
read it through at least once, probably twice, in trying to sort out the bits and pieces to use. So I hope I help you get a bit of success in terms of your sales volume.
Oh, thank you. You do. And I always, when someone buys a book, I feel like that's my dad's voice out there. Someone else is hearing his story, and I know that he would be pleased by that.
You're a, what would be called an indie, aren't you? An independent publisher, because you've done the whole thing yourself.
I did, and I had no idea what I was doing. I just decided to do it, and I learned along the way a lot. And I am going to probably have an audio version made. I'm looking into that. That's apparently popular now. And when I do that, I'll probably have a new cover made and stuff like that. But the story is the story. It will always be the story. And it was a real adventure.
How much research did you have to do to get it to where it needed to be?
I did a year's worth of it. It took me a year.
Yeah.
For the first thing, I had, I have a picture somewhere. Well, I have them downstairs. All of these notes, starting where they were typed on a manual typewriter that he sent with little snippets of stories. And when I started to put them together, I realized I didn't know what order they went in, really.
Yeah. Yeah.
And there was so much I didn't know. I began to wonder, well, where did this event happen in the overall picture of the overall war?
Yeah.
And one of the biggest problems I had was the names of the places in China.
Yeah.
They were different in 1941 and 2. After the communists came over, they changed them a couple of times at least. Yeah. And those maps, it's been so long, you couldn't even find the old maps, except some army maps. And actually even the army maps didn't always agree on the spelling of the names. Yeah. And so it was a real challenge, but I did a ton of research, and each thing I did opened a new door for me.
I can tell that I suspect there are times when you had more than one version of a particular story.
Yes.
Is that right? Because
that's right.
It's funny because I could see it in the writing, because I've got the same in Dad's book, because you were so keen to eke out every little treasured memory that sometimes you'd have similar paragraphs saying the same thing, but not quite. So
exactly.
So you used them both.
Right.
And, that
because I thought, also one thing that I sort of realized late in the process, because I would finally at some point go, this is the same thing over and over. But I realized that that's what their war was. They did the same things over and over every day. It's like we get up and go to work. Right.
Of course, yeah.
And we get in our boss hands us, here's what you're going to do today. Every day they face the same missions, flying. Yeah. These dangerous, flights over enemy territory, carrying the same type of thing. So in a way, yes, it was that. And I think part of it was his age. And I could tell some of the stories he wrote for family, and he sort of didn't put the gritty parts in there. He didn't put about casualties, and he didn't try and get too technical. Tried to keep them light. But then when he wrote them later on for memory books of his troops and stuff, he would put in a lot more stuff about like the aircraft and, aviation terms. And so I wanted it all in there. So I did combine them.
Yeah.
I wanted to get it all in there.
I think that's great. And to be honest, all these little nitty gritty technical details of how something was done, it's just fascinating because you know, you may not understand every single term, but just to be able to follow the work, the description of it, I just find it hugely interesting personally.
Oh, good. I'm so glad. I was fascinated by it too. And there were times when I think he made a typographical error or he used the wrong word, you know, something I never heard of. And then I'd look it up and I'd find out that was really real. Yeah. And that was what they called it back then. And it was pretty amazing to me to find out what primitive conditions these young, mostly men, but some women, young people were flying under, you know, practically, you know, handmade airplanes with nothing we have today, no sophisticated radar, no nothing. They were just out there on their own. And that really fascinated me.
No health and safety.
No health and safety, no.
Oh, dear. There's a story about the ripcord.
Oh, yes, the ripcord.
Tell me about the ripcord.
Well, when he jumped out of the plane, he pulled the ripcord and he never let go.
Yeah.
He said he landed and he got to the ground and, you know, figured he was all right and got his parachute out of the tree. And then he looked down and he was still holding onto the ripcord and he just stuck it in his pocket. And I think he probably held onto it in his pocket and we still have it.
Yeah.
He never let go of the ripcord. And he talks about how no one ever told him he should turn it if he had to turn it in. So he figured he could just keep it. And it was sort of his good luck symbol for life, really. And he still has it. It was just a very simple D-ring ripcord.
Yes.
When you look at the ripcord, and it's just an I'm not sure if it's aluminum, but it's like a D. And you think, wow, your life's depending on this, you know?
You didn't say aluminum then, did you?
Aluminium.
It's aluminium.
Aluminium. Okay. I love to hear you say that.
When you listen to the episode I've recorded, I've done quite a bit about how to pronounce aluminum.
Oh, that's great.
Best to twist
my sister loves it.
Well, that's a lovely souvenir for you to have, isn't it, of your dad's work?
Yes, it is. It really is a lovely souvenir.
Brilliant. Have you got a particularly favorite story about what happened to him? Is it a standout?
Well, you know, I mean, I can't help but love the stories after he had to bail out and they were lost in China. I love the story where they were walking along the road through the snow. They didn't know if they were in friendly territory or enemy territory. And he heard something behind them and he turned around and looked behind him. And there were about 20 villagers following them, looking at them. They had never seen, obviously, you know, white people or soldiers. These were native Chinese.
Yeah.
And they were amazed. But my father had really big feet for a man of that time. I think he said he wore size 13D paratrooper boots.
Wow.
And they were all pointing at his feet and laughing, but trying to be polite about it. But they were amazed by all of their paratrooper boots, because I don't know, I think they had sort of little slippers or fuzzy shoes or something, what we might consider today bedroom slippers, and they were crunching through the snow. So everyone was pointing at his feet all of the time he was in China, all of the people, and kind of laughing. So I thought that was funny. But by the time they finally got to a village, he said there were 200 people following them.
Wow.
And so I kind of like that. I kind of like that story. That's kind of neat.
That's lovely. Yeah. Okay. One thing that interested me was when you originally wrote, you said something about trying to stick to the original narrative and not to embellish the story. Just enlarge on that a little bit, could you?
Yes, I'd be happy to. I of course wanted to get this published through a real publisher,
yeah,
you know, and have it treated like an actual book. And I did contact 10 publishers.
Did you? 10? Wow.
Yeah. Most just just blew me off totally, just like, nah, forget it. Two were interested, but they said it wasn't long enough and they wanted me to rewrite it. Yeah. And they wanted me to embellish it. And one indicated they maybe if I added sort of a romantic tale, something like that. And others just, the other one just said, you know, it's not long enough. You're going to have to write more. You're going to have to add stuff.
Yeah.
And I am a lover of history. And I felt that was absolutely wrong, the wrong thing to do,
yeah.
because then it becomes fiction. Then it becomes a fictionalized memoir.
Yeah.
And that, and my goal was to put my father's story out as he told it.
Yeah.
And so I talked to my husband and several other people that were sort of historians, and they agreed with me. They said, leave it like it is,
yeah.
you know, don't change it just to make it glitzy and glossy. So I decided at that time, the only way I was going to do it was to do it myself.
Yeah.
So I did.
Yeah. Good for you. I totally support you in that, because the same temptation arose with Dad's book. And I steered the same path as you did. I didn't embellish it or try and dramatize it. I thought it was well written and it was good enough without having to be improved. So, yeah, that's great.
Good for you.
Yeah.
Good for you. That's why that's a good story too.
Absolutely. You know, Rainy, we could talk longer, but I didn't want this to... I didn't want to have a full like hours interview because we've got the book,
and I think that's right. Yeah,
talked about it's just perfect, you. Really. It's a nice little. I don't know what the word for it is, but it's a nice little.
It's sort of a little embellishment.
Yeah, sort of like just a sort little, of top and tail the episode.
It's dessert, right?
People,
it's dessert absolutely. After dinner.
Yeah, we had the main course and your dessert. Yeah,
there you go. There you go.
So I reckon we'll leave it there. And
okay.
Thank
you. I really appreciate all you've done.
Oh, well, I appreciate your efforts. I'm so pleased you've done what you've done to get it published, because every time I do an episode, I learn something about the war.
Your podcast is wonderful.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. It's funny. I've got, yeah, there's a joke in the podcasting circles about whether or not you get your friends and families to listen to your podcast. And generally they don't, because, you know, if they haven't got a natural interest in history, why would they listen to your podcast? So you tend to get your motivation from other people that you don't know, because if people you don't know say they enjoy it, then, you know, you think, well, it must be pretty reasonable. But there's a friend of mine who just started listening to us because his dad was in the war, and every two or three days he gives me a little snippet of like, I've just listened to episode 36 or whatever it may be, and I loved it. And it's so nice of him to let me know, because he's probably my one of my biggest fans now.
That's great. That's great. Oh, they're wonderful stories.
Yeah.
You really do an excellent job,
yeah.
and you pack so much into them. I love the Christmas one. I love the story about the soldiers coming for Christmas on Christmas Eve.
Yeah.
That is just, I think about that story a lot.
Yeah.
And I think that's the power of podcasts. Yeah. It gives you something to think about. You know?
It does. You're right.
Consider.
It's food. I don't know if it's food for the heart or something that hopefully makes us think, well, yeah, you know, I mean, I always feel for the Polish people, because they were so good during the war to British
yes.
prisoners of war. And they used to give them all sorts of tidbits when the Germans weren't looking. And I've got a soft spot for the Polish people as a result of that. And I don't know, it makes you want to be slightly more charitable in your attitude to all sorts of things.
It does. It does. It really does.
Yeah.
Well, that's the same thing true of, I mean, I have a very soft spot in my heart for the Chinese people, the free Chinese people, because they were so good to our soldiers. They really, really put themselves out for them.
Yes.
And in many cases, probably died for them.
Yes.
You know, in many ways. And if it weren't for their help, I don't know if my father and his compatriots would have made it home.
Yes, yes.
I think it's a real shame that there seems to be this enmity in the world at the moment between the great powers.
It's terrible. It's so sad. And that's kind of the point of the whole thing. The people don't want that.
No.
It's the politicians that want that.
Yeah, yeah. You're right. And I just wish the powers that be could straighten out the differences. And I don't know where it starts and I don't know where it finishes, but I wish they could sort it out.
Maybe that's one reason we're drawn to World War II, because all as terrible as it is, it finishes. It does finish.
Yes.
You know, and the light overcomes the dark, and we can only hope for that again.
Yeah, we can. We can. Well, Rainy, on that note, I'll say thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
And thanks for all your efforts to get your dad's
And thank memoirs. You for your yeah. efforts. I love your podcast, and I'm out there listening.
Well, I'll tell you what, we've got a little feature on the show. It's about, it's a How Good Is That award to to anybody who's put themselves out to do something really good. So hereby, on behalf of the listening public of the Fighting Through podcast, Rainy, I'll award you the How Good Is That award for this month. So
thank you. I'm honored.
Thank you very much.
All right. You.
Well, we'll speak again. And
all right, we will. And you have a great day.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Bye then. Cheerio.
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 Cheerio. Your podcast is wonderful.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
Oh, Rainy, thank you for being such a sport over that bit of editing tomfoolery, which I added at the end. You're such a sport. Thank you again, Rainy. Next episode. The North Atlantic War is here sooner than I expected. All will be revealed next time, but here's a short sneak preview of a young submariner's World War II memoir. Oh, yes, and he's German. War broke out, and we were all just the right age, 18, 19, 20, to be nice and ready to fight, and for most of us, to die. Already two good friends had fallen, and I wondered who'd be next. Thank God my little brother's only 14, I thought to myself. The monotonous pounding of the diesels was the only sign for us that we were on the move at a steady pace. Our cruising speed of around 12 knots would change only when diving or chasing. Diving had to be exercised daily to keep the crew in top readiness. However, a change of speed would be an immediate indication for us that something extraordinary was happening up there. And happen it did on our eighth day at sea. We received our U-boat Spechen submarine kit shortly after arrival. This consisted of special underwear, shoes with thick cork soles, heavily lined grey leather pants and coats, gloves, grey coveralls, blue knitted toques or beanies, heavy sweater and more. This was in addition to our already heavy supply of clothing. After nearly a month at sea on September the 10th, our bridge watch sighted a steamer. It was not even taking the precaution of sailing in a zigzag course and cruised at close range right across our path. Obviously, her lookout had not noticed us at all. She became an easy prey. We manoeuvred into position. Tubes 1 and 2, ready to fire. 1 and 2, fire! If you want to learn more, catch the next episode. No matter how long it takes, it'll be soon. Oh dear, that's good. It's going to be brilliant. Right, finishing off now. This is a bit of music now. It's from on behalf of John Garbutt from London, England. John wrote in and he said, "Hi, Paul, I was wondering if you could help supply me with the name of the song in episode 6, D-Day of D-Gray Part 1. It's during the motivating personal message from Montgomery. I heard it about 3 or 4 years ago, and I still cannot get it out of my mind even today. I wouldn't normally bother with such a minor request, but I've searched high and low, yet still cannot find it. My granddad on my mum's side was involved in World War II as a medical officer in the RAF, and he was involved with preparations for the wounded on D-Day, and also liaised with US medical officers during the Berlin airlift. Thanks, John Garbutt, London, England." John, just for you, I'm going to exit the show with this very track, and it's called Sweet Adrenaline by Delicate Beats. In fact, you've just heard bits of it during the show. It's sold on a website I use for my music called Premium Beat, which is a specialist music site for the recording and broadcasting profession. Before I play Sweet Adrenaline, I'm going to play you out with Art Tatum's V-Disc Classic 78, Body and Soul, because it seems very fitting to end the show. I'm Paul Cheel. I've got to go now. I've got some Calvados to drink from a nice new decanter. Gombe. Bye-bye now.
Hello, fellas. This has been my pleasure to make a few records for you. V-Disc, as you may call them. And I've made some popular tunes that I'm sure that some of you will enjoy. I hope all of you do. I'll be glad to see all of you back as quick as possible. Thanks.